This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
Ride, Saturday.
You know, whenever I think of the great racehorse Secretariat, I always think about what happened when he died. And they cut him open to see if there was anything different about him, and they found a heart that was way, way bigger than normal. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. Didn't mean to go kind of morbid on you there right at the beginning, but the horse's heart has a large bearing on how he can perform. Because, of course, it pumps blood and oxygenates his body and gives him what he needs. So if you are athleticizing a horse, trying to prepare him for a type of a class or an event that's going to really use that kind of energy from him, it would help to kind of keep track of how his heart is doing. An equine heart rate monitor is on the market that allows you to do that. My guest today is Chris Wentworth. He's going to talk about that. His company, Polar, is one of the leaders in human heart rate monitors, so they do know what they're talking about. That's towards the end of the show today. We're going to start out by talking with Anna Jane White-Mullin, kind of one of my go-to people on the subject of hunter-jumper riding. Now, hunters and jumpers are two different kinds of horses. Those classes are often in the same shows, though, so they kind of tend to get lumped together. We, however, will make it clear what the differences are, and Anna Jane White-Mullin will offer her thoughts on five tips for people that want to get started in that area, riding in those kind of shows. Now, this particular interview I did with Anna Jane back in 2005, and I want you to pay special attention to something she says very early in this interview. It's a story that she tells on the subject of choosing the right horse for a child. And it's a very sobering story because the right horse was not chosen for a young girl in spite of Anna Jane's advice. The reason I want you to listen to this, I tell this story in every lecture I do on finding a horse that is appropriate for you. I've got a lecture called Finding Flicka that is all about that, and I always tell this story because it is very sobering and it drives home the point that we all need a horse that's appropriate for our level of experience. I want to tell you about an event coming up on the Big Island of Hawaii, September 11th through 13th. It is the 2015 Equine Wellness Symposium, brought to you by the Hawaii Horse Expo. Seven distinguished veterinarians from around the world will be there to talk about horse diseases and problems with their health, from the very common to the very exotic, what you can do to treat them and how they can be avoided. I will be hosting, as always. In fact, it's the first time I'm billed as Dr. Lamb, so I'm kind of excited about that. Again, the dates, September 11th through 13th, 2015. Details at HawaiiHorseExpo.com. We'd love to see you there. In Hawaii. I mean, I'm just saying. Actually, my wife, Diana, is now the associate producer of the event. She gets to spend 6 weeks there. I can't believe it. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Stay with us. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at FarnamHorse.com. Farnham, your partner in horse care.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Well, welcome back, everybody. I'm Rick Lamb from the Horse Show, and we are at Equimasters Horse Expo in Puyallup, Washington. I have with me today Anna Jane White-Mullin, who is an expert in hunter-jumper competition. We're going to explore the idea of getting started in that particular sport. Anna Jane, welcome to the Horse Show.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
And by the way, do you prefer Anna or Anna Jane or Anna Jane White or Anna Jane? You've got so many names.
How do I
just kind of pick one?
Well, most people in the horse business call me Anna Jane, and that's because my dad always signed me up that way when I rode horses. He said, no one will remember Anna White. You need something snappy in there. So it was
Anna
a showbiz dad, Anna Jane White.
All right.
Then
well,
when I got married, I married a non-horseman, and he thought I should hyphenate my name because people would be looking under W instead of M. So now I have this enormous name that I have to wear everywhere I go.
Well, it's a nice name.
Well, thank you.
All right. We're going to count down five tips here. And I don't know if when you wrote these, you wrote them in any particular order, but we'll just kind of do them in the order that you gave them to me. The first thing that you suggest here is find the best instructor. And I guess my first question is, how do you define best?
Well, I think in any given area, when you go to a horse show and you watch what's happening, and particularly in the equitation division, you can see who really can teach people to ride. That if there's a barn where the people are winning a lot of ribbons, then that person's made a pretty good decision on how to teach the child and what horse is appropriate for the child. There's a lot that's said by that. Winning is not everything, but consistent winning is. You know, people who are good at something in the long run will have consistently good showing in competition. So I would think you would go to a show and see who the instructors are. They're normally near the end gate, you know, helping the people in the warm-up area and standing at the end gate watching the person perform. And I'm particularly thinking instructors for junior riders who are going to show equitation or hunters, but you also can find those instructors if you're interested in jumpers. You can go to the jumper arena and see who's training the people for that. So you sort of pick the arena where something's happening you're interested in and just be very observant. And also listen to the people in the training area. There may be somebody whose children are winning pretty well, but maybe they're very rude and loud, and you wouldn't like that. You don't want to hear that.
Yeah, I was going to say that there's a certain chemistry that has to exist between teacher and student. Sometimes the best teacher for one student might not be the best teacher for another student.
That's true. So, you know, there are a lot of different styles of teaching. So if you hear somebody and it really speaks to you, you think, I'm learning from what this person is telling that other person who's riding, and I like this person's personality, and I think I could do it.
So you look a little bit for some chemistry, it sounds to me.
That's right.
As well. And I don't want to jump the gun here, but we do want it to be fun. This needs to be something that people get pleasure from.
Yes, and I think that that's very important. You should never lose sight of that. It's a sport, and it's supposed to be fun. And when people take it too seriously, they set themselves up for all sorts of disappointments, because there are just certain things in life that should be fun and relaxing and entertaining. And, you know, not necessarily something where you feel like you failed if you're not at the top of the heap. That may be important in some aspects of life. You're trying to feed your children, you want to make a pretty good income. But when you're riding for enjoyment, you shouldn't just go home and beat yourself because you didn't win a class and, you know, you didn't live up to your expectations. Some things in life just have to be done for fun.
Now, you say here once you've picked an instructor, and I think this is only fair, once you've decided to give that instructor a chance, you got to do what that instructor says. You can't sort of pick and choose the things that you think you ought to do. You got to.
That's true. I think that if you will wholeheartedly do what they've asked you to do, then both you and the instructor can see whether it works. For instance, I may tell somebody to do something, and in the past, this has worked really well, and that's why I'm telling the student to do it. But right now, on that horse, on this day, it's not working. If the student's really trying to do it, I can see it's not working, and the student can see it, and we say, well, let's try something else. But if I'm asking them to do it, and they won't try it, then I have no way of knowing whether it would have worked or not, and they don't either. You get nowhere. You have to have trust. I think it's very much like marriage, your relationship with your trainer. You have to trust that person, and that's what it's based on. And then if you have totally trusted them and tried to do the right thing, and it's not working out, that's not the right trainer for you, then at that point you can look elsewhere. But while you are with them, you need to give them your full trust and really try to do what they're asking you to do, or nobody knows how it would have worked out.
One of the other things you suggest is a way of getting time in clinics, which can be kind of costly to attend, is to actually sponsor somebody coming, a clinician such as yourself, I would assume, coming to town and doing a presentation. And if you kind of handle the organizational aspect of that, you can usually get your participation free.
That's true. But this is what this my parents did.
Yeah, I was going to say, this is something a little bit more in the realm of what an adult would do rather than a child.
Yes.
Can they just call the clinician and say, this is what I'd like to do, you know, walk me through the process?
Yes.
And you can do that?
Absolutely.
The second thing on your list here is fairly obvious, but I think it's something that needs to be reminded to people all the time, is choose a safe and cooperative horse. Some people pick the wrong horse
They sure do, and it's such a mistake. I had a neighbor of mine, and he called when he was in his 40s, and he said his daughter was going to start riding, and he had one horse that was older that he knew they'd never get money back on because it was sort of at the end of the road, but very quiet, and then they had one that was 4 years old. And it was a little bit wild, but he thought it would be better because it would be an investment. I said, do not go that way. Get the safer horse and let her learn to ride. Well, he gets off the phone. What does he do? He goes out and he buys the four-year-old. And the girl broke her arm at the elbow and damaged it so badly she can't bend the arm now. And she was a teenager. This was a child. So people just don't take it seriously enough that having an older, well-trained horse, that is a safety factor. That is not a matter of choice with a young rider. That is simply a safety factor.
That's that old inverse relationship. One of you has to know the ropes. It's
exactly.
Either got to be the horse or it's got to be the human. But if neither one of you have the experience, it's a prescription for disaster. Absolutely.
From Equimasters, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers. My guest is Anna Jane White-Mullin. When we get back, we'll find out why she recommends starting riding on a lunge line. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why.
First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel N Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com.
This is Hugh Downs, and you're listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
I'm talking with Anna Jane White-Mullin about getting started riding hunter jumpers. Next thing on your list here is concentrate on making your position more secure, and you go into detail on lower leg and so forth. Is developing your riding seat and your riding style something that is realistic to expect a beginner to do, or is that just something want to get them working on right away?
Well, they're not going to be perfect when they start, but I think too often now, particularly if you have a trainer that's on the road all the time, they want to take the child as soon as it gets an animal that it owns and just sort of go on the road, and we'll show and we'll kind of do lessons by critiquing you in the show arena. Well, that's terrible for a beginning rider, because when you get into a show situation, you have a lot of noises and visual things going on. It's much more difficult, and you are in a competitive situation, and you are aware, you know, people are looking at you, and you tend to make more mistakes. It's better to be at home and have a safe horse and try to concentrate on getting a really secure position so that you are safe before you get out in a big area with a lot of hustle and bustle.
Now, do you think that is accomplished best by working on the hunter jumper type of riding in the arena, or working in some long trail rides on top of that?
In the arena, when you start, the more control, the better. In Europe, they put people on a lunge line, and they lunge them for a year before they allow them to even ride on their own at all, to develop their position so that their leg is correct, their seat is correct, their balance is proper.
And so they're not worried about controlling the horse at that point. They're just worried about their balance.
That's right. The trainer's just working on their position, and then eventually they take up the reins and they ride. They're still on the lunge line, and then eventually they let them off. We don't do that here, and I don't know that you have to do it that way, but it needs to be in an enclosure where you're not thinking he's just going to go back to the barn. You know, a horse, even if he's not mean, I mean, he hears the feed rustling in the barn, and he just starts plodding back. But you need to have control and feel safe. I like the contained situation.
What kind of an enclosure do you recommend? A lot of the natural horsemanship clinicians here talk about a 60-foot round pen. Is that an appropriate environment for doing this?
That would be fine for a beginner. We don't normally keep horses in a round pen when we do hunters and jumpers. We normally have places that are about anywhere from 100 feet wide to 200 long, up to 125 to 250 long.
So a good-sized arena, then, is really more what you're talking
about. That's fine, as long as it's completely enclosed, the gate is closed, and then you can lunge a person there if you want more control. If they can handle it on their own, they can stay on the railing, you know, and you can teach them rein aids to help use the railing to stop the horse if they begin to get into trouble. So you don't necessarily have to have a small enclosure, but it's not a bad idea for an absolute beginner because you're very close to them.
And you just mentioned rein aids and use of the wall. Is that if you feel like you're losing control, you can kind of move the horse
towards
the wall?
Turn him into the wall. Yeah. That's right. There's no place to go.
That'll stop him.
Yeah.
All right. You mentioned reading books on riding as the fourth item on this list. Do you find that some people are just readers and others aren't?
Yes, and I was not. I was not one that actually followed this advice when I was coming along. I had great instructors. I had the finest instructors in America just by virtue of when I was born and where I happened to be at the time. So it's just a stroke of luck. But as I began to get more advanced in my riding, each instructor would say, you should get this book, you should read this, you should have this in your library. So I was probably in my 20s before I actually took them up on it, and then I see that a lot of questions that I had could have been answered if I'd only taken the time to do that.
When you did start reading, you had a passion. You were looking.
Yes.
Okay. That's a little different than just reading it because almost like an assignment, right?
Right.
So I guess all I'm getting at is sometimes it's more effective if you're on a mission.
Yes.
for education rather than just kind of preparing yourself.
I think the way that it helps, like in my books, I try to put a lot of pictures in. So if you just read the pictures and the captions, you would learn a lot. And I think that's good for a very young writer because they don't necessarily want to read all this stuff. And then when they get a little bit older, you have your index, and if they're having trouble with their horse getting the right lead, you look at that section on that. And you can do it that way. You don't necessarily have to go cover to cover the way adult readers often do, just to get the body of information. But I think it is useful, and I'm sorry looking back on it that I didn't make more use of it because I could have progressed more quickly if I had have.
Do you think, have you had any students that have been very special students for you that have been kind of, that you've taken under your wing, that you've moved on through the ranks?
Yes, you know.
What has that experience been like for you?
Well, very interesting. I had a writer named Helen Horner, and her mother, she lived in Atlanta when I lived in Atlanta, and her mother, Lynn Horner, had brought her along quite a ways. The girl was building points for Horse of the Year in the Junior Hunter Division, and they wanted some extra work for the equitation for Metal McClay in USCT. And that's the first time I had gotten a chance to work with a writer who could really do everything I told her to do. And that's very exciting. You don't find many in your entire time of teaching that can do everything that you ask them to do.
How do you help somebody like that? It sounds like they can already do it all.
Well, there are things that they might not understand. For instance, keeping a horse collected, changing the length of the body of the horse, or where the lightness is, when you're trying to lighten the front part of the horse, the forehand, and raise where the head and neck attach onto the shoulder to elevate that. This is a whole thing about containing the center of gravity and the balance of the horse. It's pretty hard to grasp, and people have a lot of trouble doing it. And the more they try to do it, sometimes they end up just squeezing with their leg and holding with their hand, and they're in a big fight. They can't figure how to give a release point to keep the horse's brain in order and to tip the balance where they want. It's very difficult to do.
That sounds like a real give and take process.
It is. It is. And that's the thing. If people think that they can demand it, they will never get it. A horse will not tolerate it because it's painful to them. They have a couple of discs between their ears, the atlas and the axis. And if the horse's head is behind the vertical line, it stretches those discs. And it's very painful. And you'll see them foam at the mouth and sweat profusely. And sometimes people are doing this just riding, not realizing they're doing it. They're just doing it incorrectly. And the emphasis is on the head down rather than on the chest up. And it's the lightness in hunters and jumpers that enables them to be big power jumpers. So it's just an understanding of it. So even the most talented rider naturally would have a hard time getting over this if they didn't really study it. So they just need some assistance for the top level sometimes.
Still to come, can the same horse be both a hunter and a jumper? Anna Jane White-Mullin will clear that question up for us when the horse show continues. I'm Rick Lamb. Don't you dare go away. There's a whole lot more of a great show yet to come. Stay with us. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order.
Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit TrueValue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit TrueValue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Thank you, Woodman. We are back, everybody. My guest is Anna Jane White-Mullin, and we're talking about hunters and jumpers. For those who are not familiar with the difference between a hunter horse and a jumper, it's not one word, hunter-jumper. There really are two separate types of riding. Give us a quick definition of the two.
Well, the hunters are judged on their way of moving and a smoothness of jumping style and a good, clean jumping style, high legs and a round back and having even steps between the fences. So it's sort of like figure skating, where you're doing the compulsory figures that they used to have, where you're judged on exactly how precisely you do it. And then the jumpers is more like the figure skating now, where it's the big leaps and the big athletic shows. And the jumpers is how fast you can go through the course, how high you can jump, how tightly you can turn. Everything is an athletic feat. So one is more of like ballet or the arts, and the other is more like a sport and an athleticism.
Do you find very many horses cross over between the two sports and riders?
Some do. A lot of riders do. More riders do than horses do. You have some very fine hunter riders who also are your top jumper riders. They can do both. With the horses, it's harder because when you start doing the really big jumps, the horses tend to get too keyed up to be very successful in the hunters. They want to charge the fences a little. So there's not much crossover there. They usually will start as hunters and then move on into the jumper division and stay there.
So that charging of the fences, I mean, there's no down, that's not a negative if you're in a jumping class because they want the athleticism. They want to see the results, not so much the beauty of form and finesse and so forth.
Right. The way you do it doesn't count at all. It's just whether you hit it or didn't hit it and how fast you were. However, the way that you ride them is what determines how successful you are. For instance, if you don't know the flat work about lightening the forehand, you can't make the tight turn. If the horse just runs blindly at the fence, he will hit it. So you're constantly taking the horses that are all charged up from doing these time classes and taking them back over little two-foot fences and trotting back and forth over those in between your competitions to get their brain in order so they look at the jump. The scariest thing is going down to something like 5'6" and you can tell the horse isn't seeing the jump. He just as soon go through it as over it because he's so crazy now.
At any point, do you just give the horse his head and let him use his own athleticism, his own sense of when the right point to take off, the right number of steps, or are you always kind of micromanaging that?
You always manage the length of the steps, the number of the steps, the takeoff point. But once they leave the ground, they have to have complete control of the shape of their body. If you hold them too tightly and you interfere, and instead of being round over the top, they're concave, they're dished out over the top of the fence, then they don't jump well. They can't clear the big fences. And a big mistake people make is they're holding the horse to the fence to get him to the spot when he's charging a little, and then he takes off and they're still holding.
Yeah, when you see photographs of really good jumpers, you see their hands are way up on the neck in flight. They've given the horse his head completely.
They have
so
to have
he can stretch
freedom.
Out. And
until they touch the ground with their front feet.
Then they gather him back.
Then you can gather it back. And you need what I call a short rein with a light feel. So you can immediately get to the rein, but you have a very light and elastic feel on the mouth. And hopefully you won't have much of them really charging where you're having to pull back. If you ride pretty well, the horse knows what's coming. And they can stay in a frame fairly light between the fences as well as in the air. It's a matter of precision and training.
Yeah. You know, I couldn't help but flash on Christopher Reeve that had the terrible accident jumping, because his accident occurred, as I understood it, right when he came back to the ground. Is that correct? And he got entangled in the bridle?
Well, I think
bridle?
What happened to him is his hands, both hands, got entangled in the reins. And so when he came down, it jerked his hand somehow either like through his legs or to the side, where he hit straight down head first. Ooh. He had a helmet, but it was the impact of slamming straight down that broke just an eighth of an inch, apparently, of a nerve down the back of his neck. So it's a tiny little place it damaged, but it, you know, critically injured.
Did that hurt the sport, do you think, when that happened? Did that
turn people away? Well, I don't think it got anybody to want to suddenly do it.
It wasn't real good on the PR side, to say nothing of what it did to him. But, I mean, did you notice any fallout?
No, I don't think there's been any drop in it. And, you know, one thing that was disappointing for people is there had been this huge campaign about wearing helmets, and he was one of the main advocates of that. And he was wearing a helmet and was still severely injured. But if he had not had the helmet, it would have killed him. The blow would have killed him. So, you know, it did save his life. And the helmets are a great thing. They certainly should be there. But people did not want the poster boy for helmets ending up being a paraplegic. That
didn't
help.
Well, it's interesting watching his struggle to, you know, his determination not to be forever in that condition and the strides he's made along that way. We kind of hinted at the last item on this list before, and that is purely and simply you need to do this riding for your own enjoyment. You can't do it because your parents want you to. You can't do it from peer pressure.
Right.
And you point out something very interesting. You can't do it trying to prove something.
Right. I think a lot of times when I'm with people in clinic situation, because I see so many that I don't know at all, I just walk in the arena and I suddenly have four or six riders that I don't know. And invariably in a clinic, someone will come up and say, you know, I'm really scared to jump. How do I overcome the fear of jumping? And in my mind, that's not something you have to overcome. I think people are thinking about it that they see their friends doing it and I should feel comfortable doing it, and they just don't. And they think it's some kind of a human failing. And I just don't see it that way at all. You don't have to jump that fence.
You sound like someone who, though, probably never had much of a fear of jumping.
I don't, but I don't because I really want to be safe, and I work very hard in my position to be safe, and I really want to be in control of the situation, and I work very hard with the horse to be completely in control. So when I'm galloping down to a fence, I feel that I'm safe, and I feel that I'm in control. But that's years and years and years of work to get there, of doing the things maybe other people aren't willing to do, like posting trot without stirrups. And every day you do it. And that's what gives me the glue and gives me the emotional security. But again, if I did not feel like jumping and I felt the peer pressure of it, that would not be enough to compel me to do it.
Which is the greater fear that riders have, that they will lose their seat in the jump, or that the horse will refuse the jump and they will go flying over it?
Kind of both. I think more are afraid of the horse stopping and that they keep on going, and that is the most dangerous of the two.
When you ride a horse, can you tell how far away can you tell this horse is going to refuse this?
Long
jump?
Way away.
Really? Right. What is it in the horse that tells you that?
You feel, instead of everything willingly going forward, you begin to feel their chest come back towards you. You feel them backing up. And what it actually is a shortening of the steps.
Mm-hmm.
As they get unsure about it, they start setting themselves up to stop. They want that hind and underneath and the front feet pushing back on the dirt so they can slide to a stop the way that a horse does in roping or something like that.
Yeah.
That's what they're trying to do when they refuse. They don't like to go skidding in head first. So they're trying to set up. That's your first indication, is when that chest starts coming back towards your body.
Is there anything the rider can do when she feels that?
Absolutely.
What do you do?
Well, you always try to drive them forward. Your driving aids are your leg, your spur, and your stick. And you do them in that order. So if the horse starts to what we call suck back away from the fence, you drive with your leg. If you get no response, you add the spur. If you get no response, you add the stick, and it's boom, boom, boom.
Is that one of those things that you do whatever it takes? You escalate the pressure to whatever level it needs to get the result you want?
Yes, and usually it's not much. You know, people think of it as somebody having to beat the horse over the fence, and I've never had to do anything like that. When the horse is coming to the fence, the first time it crosses his mind, you know, maybe I'll just stop on this gal. And if you go with the stick, he says, well, maybe I just won't step on this gal.
Before it's become set in his mind. Yeah.
That's right. It's the perception that you're onto the horse, where he says, well, you know, this isn't worth doing because she knows where I'm going with this.
Yeah.
So if you can just outthink him a little bit, it helps a lot.
You mentioned that you've got some books. Tell us about the books that you've written.
Well, I've got a couple of books. One is Judging Hunters and Hunter Seat Equitation. And then the second book is from the other side of it. It's training for the show ring.
Anna, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
So you're doing all this training with your horse. How do you know if it's actually making him any fitter? Well, one way you could find out is by checking his heart rate. And we've got just the device for that. Chris Wentworth will tell us all about it when the horse show continues.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit TrueValue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit TrueValue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Hard work comes with a lot of sweat. That's why there's new Wrangler Cool Vantage jeans. They keep you cool by wicking sweat 5 times faster. They keep you dry by pulling moisture to the outside where it dries faster. They keep you comfortable so you're less restricted all day long. New Wrangler Premium Performance Cool Vantage Jeans. The newest innovation in comfort.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you. Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
Well, welcome back, everybody. You know, as often happens, developments in human medicine get sort of modified and work their way into equine medicine. We're going to talk about one of those today. It is a heart monitor that is made by the company that is the big dog, really, in the making of human heart monitors. They're named Polar, and they are now making the Polar Horse Heart Rate Monitor. My guest is Mr. Chris Wentworth. Chris, welcome to the Horse Show.
Well, thank you for having me, Rick.
Now, back on the human side, is this something that you are marketing primarily to, like, the athlete or the person that was training for maybe a marathon, or was this something more targeted to doctors?
It's really was developed generally as a product for widespread use, for all the way from athletes to people that just want to stay in shape to people that have perhaps heart disease or cardiovascular problems. The basic idea here is that you're getting feedback on your heart rate, how fast your heart's beating. So if you're any person, whether you want to lose weight, you're trying to train for competition, you're trying to recover from a heart attack, or anywhere in between, you know what's going on because you know your heart rate. And if you've got a professional that indicates, well, if you're at this heart rate, you're going to burn this many calories, or if you're an athlete, if you burn this many, if your heart rate's at this level, you're going to train in an optimum way for competition. It's like putting another instrument on your dashboard to know what's going on with your body, and then you can train intelligently around that because you're getting accurate feedback.
Good analogy, and I presume that all those same benefits would exist when you take this technology over into the horse world.
Yeah, they do, and there's an initial benefit as well. And since the horse, you know, can't talk to you, you know, it gives you a window into their physiology and their heart rate, and it gives you a really valuable training tool, essentially a training and health assessment tool.
Horses are individuals, like humans are individuals. Mm-hmm. When you are looking at the heart rate monitor, is it going to be the same for every horse? I mean, are the same ranges meaning the same things for every horse?
Overall sense, they do. I mean, horses will have a lower resting heart rate, which is if you're completely still, and they'll have usually a higher maximum heart rate when you're going full blast and your heart rate's up as high as it will go. And with horses, the heart rate will tend to shoot up faster in response to exercise, and it will tend to come down a little bit faster.
Now, I know when I did a lot of running, my resting heart rate was lower. Mm-hmm. Than when I wasn't in as good a shape. Is that same thing true with horses?
Right. Interestingly enough, whether the horse is in shape or not in shape, resting heart rate is fairly similar. Usually it's down around 28 to 32 beats a minute. But you'll see other substantial differences between a fit horse and a horse that's not fit in heart rate if you look at other areas of the heart rate feedback.
Now, what kind of things are you talking about there? What other things can it tell you?
On the conditioning side, there are two things. One is called recovery heart rate. So you go out and you exercise your horse. When you come back, the question is, how quickly does that heart rate come from an exercise level back down to a resting level?
Mm-hmm.
And the quicker the heart rate recovers, the better shape that horse is in. So you can just get recovery heart rate over a period of time, and you can see if your horse is getting in better shape.
So that would be an indicator that he is getting more conditioned, is how quickly
Absolutely.
He comes back down. Yeah.
Absolutely. And also, if the heart rate's taking too long to recover, then you know, hey, maybe something's a little bit wrong. And it's just a good way to pick up, you know, if everything's functioning normally with the horse or if something's a little bit off. And if I could just elaborate on that point further, one of the biggest groups of people that use horse heart rate are the endurance riders.
Yeah.
And as your listeners probably know, these guys go, you know, 25, 50, or 100 miles in a 24-hour period. And you know, that's a lot of work on the horse. Since the beginning of endurance racing, they've instituted something called a vet check, where let's say you have a 100-mile race, and periodically you come to a vet check stop, and you actually have a veterinarian check the horse, and one of the things they're looking at is recovery heart rate. So has that heart rate dropped back down to a level that's within an acceptable level, or is the heart rate just not coming down? If the heart rate's not coming down, usually the horse is overstressed or dehydrated or injured, something like that. So that will flag the vet, like, okay, something's off here, and they'll pull that horse out of the race.
Now, you, in this line, this is not just a device. You have a whole line of horse heart monitors.
Right.
And I would presume that some of them, from the descriptions, they sound like some of them are oriented more to the use of a vet at a vet check, for instance, the handheld models. Others might be something that you could attach to the horse. You've got a receiver on your wrist. You could be actually monitoring this while you're riding.
Right. Yeah, in terms of the product line, there are two essential components. One is this handheld heart rate pickup. So you're dismounted, you're standing next to the horse, and you just place, it's a thing that weighs a couple of ounces, and you just put it up alongside the horse near the horse's elbow, and it will pick up the heart rate within about 10 seconds.
Well, then does it have like a LED readout or something?
Yeah, there's a little wristwatch you can put on your wrist, and then you put this device up alongside the horse. The device, the handheld component that you're putting up alongside the horse, sends a low-frequency signal about 3 feet. So it'll just come over to your wristwatch. You look at the wristwatch, and there's your heart rate.
So it's a whole wireless system?
It's a wireless system for that handheld, yeah. And they're low-cost. Those things are under $100.
Yeah.
They're extremely accurate. The way they work, and whether the riding heart rate or the that handheld, every time a horse's heart beats or a human heart beats, it will make an electrical signal. For every beat, there's an electrical signal. And I'm sure most of your listeners have seen that little EKG graph, the squiggle that you see.
Sure.
The highest point on that is called the R wave. And whenever that's the most voltage or electrical signal a horse will put out. So whenever there's a little burst of electrical energy like that, this device picks it up. And then sends that signal to the watch, and then it calculates your average per minute. So they're completely accurate, and they're a no-brainer kind of use. You don't have to listen to anything or hear anything.
I was going to say, you don't have to count and, like, look at your wristwatch.
Exactly.
Do your math and all
exactly.
that.
Exactly. It's dead accurate, and it just, you know, takes about 10 seconds to compute the average heart rate.
So when people are on an endurance ride, and they're really serious about, you know, performing well, and they want to kind of pace their horse properly, are they monitoring their horse's heart rate while they're riding?
It depends on the rider.
We're talking about a real serious one here. This, you know, the latest technology.
Yeah, the serious rider. I mean, the key really is not so much. Although you want to monitor the horse while you're riding, that's great. But the key really isn't the training process, because you're building your horse up day by day, week by week, to get race ready. Mm-hmm. And then once you're racing the horse, the monitor can also come in handy, because you know how hard you can work that horse for what long of a period of time. I mean, I know I've talked to endurance people, and they know if they keep the horse, let's say the particular horse's maximum heart rate is 220.
Mm-hmm.
They know that if they keep that horse somewhere at around 180 or 175 or 180, that horse can go 24 hours. They know if they put that horse up to 195 beats a minute, that horse is going to burn out, and it's not going to be able to complete 24 hours.
Now,
they know if they're at 160 beats a minute, the horse is really going below what the capability is, and they could push the horse to get more performance out of the horse. So they know essentially how hard they can work the horse at what heart rate to complete the race to get them. And if they go above it, it's not going to work, and to go below, it's not going to work.
Yeah, it almost sounds a little bit like a speedometer or a tachometer, you know, on an automobile. You can tell how hard you're stressing
exactly.
The system. What happens, this is a dumb question, but that's my job. You said maximum heart rate, which, of course, makes me think, what happens when you exceed the horse's maximum heart rate? Is that when he is in danger of collapsing or something?
No, it's... it's just sort of like on an engine, you'll have a governor that it will not go above a certain RPMs per minute.
Uh-huh.
It just, and that's how human heart rate is, that's how horse heart rate is. As you get going faster and faster, you reach a point where your heart simply will not beat any faster.
Oh, okay.
And this is done all the time for fitness tests, if for a human, for a horse. You just get that horse up to the maximum, and that's just as fast as its heart will beat. If the horse puts up more effort, it might even pick up speed a little tiny bit, but the heart rate will not go up any higher.
I see. So that's about as fast as that muscle
the heart being a muscle,
yes.
as that muscle can work on that animal.
That's right. That's right. And I think nature creates it that way so that, you know, there's a top limit to heart rate. Beyond that, the heart won't go any faster, and it protects the heart muscle.
Yeah. Now, a lot of what we've been talking about also involves time and mm-hmm. kind of keeping this all in, you know, keeping track of how long it takes you to get from point A to point B or how long the horse mm-hmm. has been operating at this certain heart level. Is that one of the parameters that shows also on your monitor is lapse time, or is there use
yeah,
your wristwatch for that or what?
They have they'll have a stopwatch. They will have depending on the model, they'll have something that indicates how many minutes a horse was in a certain heart rate range, or they will show the average heart rate for the whole workout. And on the high end, we have monitors that will actually heart monitors that will record the whole exercise session. And so after you finish exercising, you can actually see a little chart on a computer screen showing all the heart rate activity and how long they exercised at what heart rate.
Now, this might sound, folks, like this is going to be an extremely expensive piece of equipment, but as I understand it, Chris, your low-end model, the kind of the wristwatch version, $99.95. Up to the high-end version is only $414.95. Are those still correct numbers?
Right. The handheld to get the resting heart rate is somewhere between $89 and $99.
Yeah.
And then for riding, the entry-level heart monitor is about $149. Then you get up to the computer ones, they're around $400.
Yeah.
There's actually two of them. One's for one will pick up altitude, temperature, and if you're doing a sulky. It'll pick up speed from the wheel.
Wow.
And then the other, and all that gets recorded in the download, so you can see the heart rate, altitude, temperature, and speed.
My guest has been Chris Wentworth of Polar Horse Heart Rate Monitors, and that website, Chris, correct me if I'm wrong, I have www.heartmonitor.com. Is that correct?
Yes.
And they can probably learn about human heart monitors there as well, I would imagine.
They can. And also with the horse section, there's a lot of free informational articles on all the, you know, training and all these things that we've discussed. There's a lot of free information there that can be available to your reader, to your listeners.
Outstanding. Well, I appreciate you being on the horse show today. Thanks very much, Chris.
Thank you so much.
You bet. Take care.
Bye-bye.
And there you have it, my friends. Special thanks to my guests today, Anna Jane White-Mullin and Chris Wentworth. Remember, any device that can play YouTube videos can now play The Horse Show on radio or television. Just go to my website, thehorseshow.com. Click the radio button if you'd like to listen to past editions of the radio program, or TV if you're interested in TV. Again, any device that can play YouTube videos can now get all of our content. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.